Then, good morning to everybody, and thanks for the opportunity of giving this talk. I will speak about the route that led to the proof of the property that Gaussian quantum states minimize the output entropy of Gaussian quantum channels for given input entropy. So, and that's the why the title Gaussian optimizers in quantum information. Then, here's the outline of the talk. I will start by introducing Gaussian quantum systems and Gaussian quantum channels. And then I will state the problem, the minimizing the output entropy of the channel for given input entropy. And then I will present the various steps of the proof that we did. So the first step is proving that we can restrict to states diagonal in the Fock basis. So it's that are called passive states. And then the problem becomes a classical problem in discrete probability. And then I will present the proof for the quantum attenuator. And then to extend the result to all the other Gaussian quantum channels, I will need some more step. So I will need to consider as an intermediate step the, let's try this, okay. I will need to prove that Gaussian states optimize the so-called P2Q norms of the amplifier, and I will explain what these P2Q norms are. And then finally the proof for all the Gaussian channels and the conclusions. Then we can start. So we consider the Hilbert space of one harmonic oscillator or one mode of the electromagnetic radiation. And A will be the ladder operator of this Hilbert space that satisfies the well-known canonical commutation relation, this one here. So this system is in the communication task is meant as the Hilbert space of one of the modes of electromagnetic radiation, and then the Hamiltonian is the one that counts the number of photons, and it's this one here in terms of the ladder operator. And once we introduce this Hamiltonian, we can diagonalize it, and we can its eigenbasis is the famous Fock basis, and it is well known that this Hamiltonian has integer spectrum, so this will be the eigenbasis of the Hamiltonian. Then we can introduce Gaussian thermal states, and Gaussian thermal states are simply the Gibbs states of the number Hamiltonian, so the states of this form here. And of course, if you, so this beta is positive and it's the inverse temperature, and if you send beta to infinity, we recover the ground state of the Hamiltonian, that is the vacuum. So these are not all the Gaussian states that exist. There are also the so-called squeezed Gaussian states, but we will not need them in the proof. Then we can now introduce Gaussian quantum channels. So mainly Gaussian quantum channels model the attenuation and the noise that affects any traveling electromagnetic signal. And they can divide it in two categories, the so-called attenuators and the so-called amplifiers. So the attenuators can be represented by beam splitter. So we have here the input state, that's the input radiation. This radiation is a beam splitter and is partly transmitted and partly reflected here. And there is also this second input port of the beam splitter. And here we will put the noise that will be added to the signal. And in the case of a Gaussian channel, this noise is given by a quantum Gaussian state. So I call that state omega E, that is E stands for environment. So mathematically, this beam splitter performs a mixing of the So the electric field in the outputs will be a linear combination of the electric fields of the two inputs. And this is implemented by this unitary operator U that acts on this way on the ladder operator. So A is the ladder operator of the input system, and E is the ladder operator of the environment. And this lambda here goes from 0 to 1 and is the transmission coefficient of this splitter. And mathematically, this is the expression for the channel. That is, we take the input state, we append the ancillary Gaussian quantum state, we perform this unitary rotation that implements the beam splitter, and then we throw away this output port of the environment. Then there is a second kind of Gaussian quantum channels that are called amplifier, and they are similar to the attenuators, but the difference is that this time this unitary operator U implements a two-mode squeezing between the input state and the state of the environment. And while you can implement a beam splitter with passive elements, that is, the beam splitter does not need energy to work, here you need energy to implement this two-mode squeezing. And indeed, here, even if the environment state is in the vacuum and the input state is in the vacuum, you will get a thermal state with some positive temperature in the output. So first, why are these called Gaussian channels? The answer is simple, and it's that they preserve the set of Gaussian quantum states. So if the input is a Gaussian quantum state, also the output will be a Gaussian quantum state, of course, with a different temperature. Then some terminology. If the environmental state is the vacuum, then the channel is called quantum limited, and we will have a quantum limited attenuator and a quantum limited amplifier. And these two channels are important because they are the building blocks of all Gaussian quantum channels, because it's possible to prove that any Gaussian quantum channel can be expressed as an attenuator composed with an amplifier. And we will need this relation in the following. So why are these channels important? Because they represent the attenuation and noise that affects electromagnetic signals, and then they are relevant for quantum communication. Then we can present our problem, and the problem is we fix the input von Neumann entropy of the input state. Of course, I remember that the von Neumann entropy is minus the trace of rho logarithm of rho, where rho is the density matrix associated to the state. So I fix the von Neumann entropy of the inputs, and I ask the question, when is the entropy of the output minimum? And the answer to this question will be the output entropy is minimum when the input state is a thermal Gaussian state. So I take a generic state. This is the Gaussian state with the same entropy of the initial state. I put both these states through the channel, and then I will prove that the output entropy of the state generated by the Gaussian state is always smaller than the output entropy of the output associated to the generic state. Why is this problem relevant? This problem, the solution to this problem is relevant for various communication tasks involving Gaussian quantum channels. So the first task is the so-called triple trade-off region of the quantum limited attenuator and the quantum limited amplifier. So what is the triple trade-off region? In this region, it's made by the triple of rates with which I can perform simultaneously these three communication tasks. That can be, in one case, the transmission of classical information, the transmission of quantum information, that is, I want to send a quantum state, and the generation of shared entanglement between the sender and the receiver. So this is one situation. And then we have a second situation where the three tasks are the transmission of private information, that is, I do not want any eavesdropper to be able to read this information, the transmission of standard classical public information, and the generation of a shared secret key between the sender and the receiver. So this inequality is needed to prove that Gaussian encodings are the best strategy for performing these tasks. And in this case, it is so the best use of the channel is not to use the channel for some time for the first task, for some time for the second task, and for some other time for the third task, but the best use of the channel performs these three tasks simultaneously. And in this way, we can prove that Gaussian encodings are the best. So the second scenario where this inequality is important is the so-called capacity region of the degraded broadcast channel. So how is this channel? Let's suppose to have a mean splitter. We have the sender here, and we have two receivers. So one receiver will be here, and another receiver will be on this second output of the mean splitter. And we want to send, to communicate with both receivers and send different messages to them. Then this inequality permits to prove that also in this case, Gaussian encodings are the best strategy for this communication task. And also in this case, the best strategy is not to communicate for a fraction of the time only with the first receiver and for another fraction of the time only with the second receiver, but the best strategy is to communicate with both simultaneously. Then one thing that it's important to say is that while the first communication task just in the case of the amplifier just requires the one mode version of this inequality, so we need to prove them just for one mode channels. All the other tasks, so the triple trade-off region of the quantum limited attenuator and the capacity region of the degraded broadcast channel, require this inequality in the multimode case. That is when I have the channel acts on the tensor product of many modes of the electromagnetic radiation, and it acts in the same way on each mode. Then, how to prove this inequality? First, I have to say that in the classical case, we instead of quantum Gaussian channels, we have classical Gaussian channels, and that property is known to be true. But the relevant inequality is called entropy power inequality. One could seem to use the same proof technique as in the classical case. And actually, you can prove quantum entropy power inequality with the same proof technique, but unfortunately, this inequality is not saturated by quantum Gaussian states, and then it's not sufficient to prove our result. And then one needs some different techniques. So I will introduce here two concepts that will be relevant for the proof. The first concept is the concept of majorization. So given two quantum states, rho and sigma, I will say that sigma majorizes rho, and write in this symbol, if and only if rho can be obtained applying to sigma a convex combination of unitary operators. So that is a way of saying that rho is more noisy than sigma. And this majorization, of course, is an order relation, but it's not a complete order relation. So given two states, it can happen that rho does not majorize sigma and sigma does not majorize rho. Why is this relevant for our problem? Because if rho is majorized by sigma, then the entropy of rho is larger than the entropy of sigma. And actually, one can easily show that any concave functional, any concave unitarily invariant functional computed on rho will be larger than the same functional computed on sigma. Then the second relevant concept for the proof is the concept of passive states. So what are passive states? Passive states are the states that minimize the average energy for a given spectrum. So let's consider a generic state rho. We can always diagonalize it. So this will be the eigenvalues and this will be the eigenvectors. And we can always put the eigenvalues in decreasing order. So what shall we do to minimize the, so for this given spectrum, to minimize the average energy? Of course, we will have to put the largest eigenvalue on the state with the lowest energy, that is the vacuum. And then we will take the next to largest eigenvalue and we will associate it to the eigenstate with next to smallest energy, that is Fock 1. And then we continue in this way and we will associate Pn to the state Fock n. So in this way, we build this state, this new state that we call the passive rearrangement of rho. And this passive arrangement is diagonal in the Fock basis, and its eigenvalues decrease as the energy increases. So how can we connect all this to our problem? Instead of considering the problem of fixing the input entropy and asking when the output entropy is minimum, we consider this variant of the problem. So we fix the whole spectrum of the input state and we ask what is the optimal input state with a given spectrum. And as you can imagine from the previous slide, the answer is that the optimal input state for a given spectrum is the passive state, that is the passive rearrangement of the initial state. And this optimality is in the sense of majorization, that is, we have been able to prove that so rho is a generic state. This rho with the arrow is its passive rearrangement. And the property is that the output generated by a generic state is always measurized by the output generated by its passive rearrangement. And then, as I told before, the output generated by a generic state has always a larger entropy than the output generated by its passive arrangement. What does this mean? So rho and its passive arrangement have the same spectrum and then they have the same entropy. And this means that for our problem of minimizing the output entropy for a given input entropy, it is sufficient to consider passive input states. So these states are diagonal in the Fock basis. And then the problem becomes a problem in classical discrete probability. So all the quantum part of the problem has been washed out. So the only problem of all this is that it works just for one mode, because it is possible to prove that already for two modes, this relation does not hold. And among the input state with a given spectrum, in general, it is not possible to find one of these states that generates an output that majorizes all the other outputs. So we can do this just for one mode. And if one wants an intuitive explanation of why this fails for two modes, the explanation is that while for one mode, the Hamiltonian is non-degenerate, and then we have a unique definition of passive arrangement. For more than one mode, the Hamiltonian becomes degenerate. And then the state that minimizes the energy for a given spectrum is no more unique. And this generates some troubles. Then we can move to the proof of the property for the quantum attenuator. So the key property of the quantum attenuator that we are using is first one, that the composition of two quantum attenuators is still a quantum attenuator with attenuation parameter that is the product of the attenuation parameter of the two original attenuators. And second, that Gaussian states are sent to Gaussian state by this quantum limited attenuator. Then the idea is that, for example, if we have proved the inequality for this, for the attenuatory parameter lambda, for the attenuatory parameter lambda prime, we get it for the attenuator with the product of the parameter. And then it is sufficient to prove the inequality just for the infinitesimal attenuator. That is, it is sufficient to prove that the derivative of the entropy with respect to the attenuation parameter, computed in the attenuation parameter equals to one, that is the identity, for given entropy of the state, is maximized by Gaussian state. Here the sign of the inequality changes just because this parameter is smaller than one, and then this generates a minus sign here. So the finite inequality just follows from integrating this infinitesimal inequality. Then we have to prove this, and how to prove this inequality. We used Lagrange multipliers for the proof, but then there is the problem that the Hilbert space is infinite dimensional, and then we have to use Lagrange multipliers with an infinite number of variables. And to overcome this problem, we first restricted to input states with finite support, and then we extended the result by continuity to all the input states. Why is it easy to, we can restrict to input state with finite support? Because there is the lucky property that the quantum attenuator, if sends input state with finite support to input states with finite support. Because if you, the attenuator does not add any photons to the state, and then if the state has a bounded maximum number of photons, also the output state will have a bounded maximum number of photons. Then the amplifier and all the other channels. So one could think to use the same proof, so prove the infinitesimal version of the inequality with Lagrange multipliers also for the other Gaussian channels. But now we have the problem that even if the input state has finite support, the output state will always have full support. And then there are some problems with Lagrange multipliers, because it's no more true that Gaussian states are the only solution to the Lagrange multipliers equations. And then we have to change strategy. So the strategy is to using the to prove that Gaussian states achieve the so-called P to Q norms of Gaussian quantum channels. So what are these P to Q norms? First, given a quantum state, we define its P norm as the trace of rho to the P to the 1 over P this here. And then the property, so the P to Q norm of a quantum channel is the supremum over all the inputs of this quantity. So the Q norm of the output divided by the P norm of the input. So the property that we proved is that this supremum is achieved by Gaussian states. Then how to prove this, because it seems that we will have again the same problem that we had with the entropy. There is always the problem of the support that the amplifier does not send state with finite support to states with finite support. But then there is this particular property, and this property is that the amplifier happens to be the dual channel to the attenuator, and this means this relation here. So that for any, let's say, trace class operators x and y, the trace of x with the amplified y is proportional to the trace of the attenuated x times y. And it is a well-known fact that the P to Q norms of a quantum channel are related to the P to Q norms of its dual in this way. And then we can just compute the P to Q norms of the attenuator, and we have for free the P to Q norms of the amplifier. And for the attenuator, since states with finite support are sent to states with finite support, we can use Lagrangian multipliers and restrict to states with finite support and have a problem with a finite number of variables. Then the version of the inequality that we actually needed is this one. So we proved that given a Gaussian state, for any Q larger than one, that is the exponent associated to the output, I can choose an exponent associated to the input, a P, such that this P to Q norm is saturated by the Gaussian state chosen in the beginning, so that such that this inequality holds. Okay. How to relate this with the entropy problem? So first, the Schatten norms of the quantum states are related to the Reni entropies, since the Reni entropy is substantially proportional to the logarithm of the Schatten norm times this factor. The nice property of these Reni entropies is that they are always smaller than the von Neumann entropy, and they tend to the von Neumann entropy in the limit p tends to 1. Then we have a relationship between these Schatten norms and the Reni entropies, and then the von Neumann entropy. Then the idea is to take this inequality here and rewrite it in terms of Reni entropy instead then of these norms. And what comes out if one does this is this is the same inequality. So I said, as before, for any Gaussian state there will and any Q, there will exist an exponent P such that this inequality holds for any state row. Then what shall I do? I choose the quantum state row for which I want to prove my inequality. I choose as Gaussian state the Gaussian state with the same entropy of rho. Then for any Q, I can choose P such that this inequality holds. And then I just take the limit Q tends to 1. So this will tend to the von Neumann entropy of the amplified version of rho. This will tend to the von Neumann entropy of the amplified version of the Gaussian state with the same entropy as rho. And this tends to 0, because these guys both tend to the von Neumann entropy of rho, and this is bounded. Then, taking the limit in this inequality, I get exactly what I wanted. The output entropy of the associated to the generic state is larger than the output entropy associated with the Gaussian state with the same entropy. And then, final point, as I told before, I can write any Gaussian channel as a quantum-limited attenuator composed with a quantum-limited amplifier. Then I can use both the inequality that I have proved for the attenuator and the amplifier, compose them, and get the inequality for the generic Gaussian channel. So. Then, conclusion. I proved that Gaussian input states minimize the output entropy of one mode Gaussian channels for given input entropy. And what are now the open problems? So the most important open problem is the generalization of this conjecture to the multimode case that is still needed for its information theoretical applications. And the second generalization is the so-called entropy photon number inequality, where, so I can take back the drawing of the splitter. In this setup here, I don't fix the environmental state to be a Gaussian state, but this is free to be whatever. And the idea is that now I fix both the von Neumann entropy of this output and this other output. And I ask of this, sorry, these inputs. And I ask when is the output entropy minimum, and the answer is still conjectured to be when they are both thermal Gaussian states. And for this, we do not have a proof even for one mode. So that's all. Thanks for the attention.
Thanks very much. So we have some time for questions.
I'd like to ask if you have an analogous result for finite dimensional Hilbert space. So for example, usually when I think of Gaussian state, I would translate that into stabilizer state in finite dimensional Hilbert space. So do you have any comments on that?
Okay, no, I don't have, for the moment, I don't have results for finite dimensional Hilbert space, but there you don't just need a class of, so for this result, you need both a class of channels to which you want to apply the statement, and also you need a class of channels, also then a class of states. Then you will need something, an analog of Gaussian channels for these stabilizer states. So the idea could be to prove that stabilizer states minimize the output entropy for given input entropy for the channels that preserve the set of stabilizer states. But I never looked at this problem.
Mark?
Do you have other applications of your P to Q norm results? Because it seems like a very general result that could be applied other places.
So for the moment, other than these results, it can be used for having a result for the Rényi entropies, that is, you have this inequality here. And then there will be some other mathematical application in mathematical physics for that result. So mainly, you can prove that if you consider the spaces with of operator with bounded P norms, you can prove that these Gaussian channels send the state with bounded P norm in states with bounded Q norm for any Q larger than P. Okay, here I didn't tell that if Q is strictly smaller than P, then this supremum is infinite. That's why you have this relation here. So we have proved that Gaussian channels send the states with bounded P norm to states with bounded Q norms for any Q larger or equal than P.
I've got a question. You gave a nice sort of intuitive explanation as to why the earlier results worked only for a single mode and don't really extend to the multimode case. For these new techniques that you've introduced, can you give us an explanation as to why it might be hard to go to the multimode case?
So here the problem is that all of these relies on Lagrange multipliers. And you need to impose a Lagrange multiplier to fix the input entropy. And the problem is that if you know that the state is diagonal in a given basis, then you just have the, it's simple to compute. So the entropy needs to compute the logarithm of the density matrix. And if you already know the eigenbasis of the density matrix, then the logarithm is simple to compute. While if the matrix is not constrained to be diagonal in a given basis, the logarithm of the matrix is not related, so you cannot express the entries of the logarithm of the matrix as an analytic function of the entries of the matrix. And that's why you cannot, the same proof with Lagrange multipliers does not go through.
Thanks. Any final questions? If not, let's thank our speaker again.